good morning to all, and thank you for your presence. We are going to talk about astigmatism correction with the Toric EOL that introduces a new concept for pupil independence and misalignment tolerance. But first, we talk a little bit about the Toric market. And as you know, corneal astigmatism is frequent in cataract patients and has a major impact to the refractive outcomes of surgery. Pre-existing corneal astigmatism remains a challenge to achieve excellent and correct visual acuity. But what about costs? Several studies show us that Toric EOLs reduce lifetime economic costs by reducing the need of glasses or contact lenses following cataract removal. And these results, as you can see, can inform physicians and patients regarding the value of Toric EOLs in the treatment of cataract and astigmatism. And it's true and well known that Toric EOL can provide better visual outcomes and is the most stable and predictable way to correct astigmatism. The surgeon should keep in mind that for the final outcome is very important a proper selection of patients. Precise astigmatism measurement, EOL calculation, EOL placement, and EOL rotational stability are essential for success. Because early toric models were rotationally unstable, their correcting effect was limited. Stable and effective toric EOLs implanted in the capsular bag, they are therefore important advancement in modern cataract surgery. As you can see from Alpine data, for instance, for a 10 degrees rotation, there is a significant loss of effectiveness, but also an astigmatism rotation 40 degrees apart. But what we know about the effect of pupil size on visual acuity in pseudophakic eyes with toric EOLs? Some studies indicated that pupil size may have an impact in visual quality. Residual astigmatism has been related to pupil size because of difference in the central and peripheral power and the increase of high-order aberrations. Special in young patients with large pupils who undergo toric EOL implantation. Toric EOL is still improving with more powers and customization, with a better cylinder calculation, and with new EOL materials and designs which allows rotational stability. As you know, the introduction of aspheric EOLs was a great evolution in quality of vision. And now, the Precizon EOL introduces a new concept, the atoricity, or transitional conic toric EOL. Atoricity is an extension of aspheric design technology, allowing lens designers to optimize for both the sphere and the cylinder power of the lens. And that is because spheral cylinder correction produces a retinal image that are asymmetrical magnified and with peripheral distortion of this kind in positive lenses. So a lens with a toric surface can provide better control of peripheral optical aberrations in lens with cylinder power. Note how you can see the mouse. No. If you see here the atoric lens, note how in atoric lens the relative asphericity correction factor change from meridian to meridian. In a sense, each meridian of the lens has been adjusted by changing the amount of asphericity from one meridian of the lens to another. So the toric lens can provide a wider field of vision and provides optical performance superior to conventional lens designers over a wide range of lens powers. With this approach, the spherical equivalent diopter power will be constant from the center of the lens till the edge, and which will be especially important, of course, in larger pupils, as you can see. As a second feature of the constant power per meridian is that the meridian gets broader in the periphery when compared to the standard toric EOLs. That makes the lens theoretical more forgiveness for misalignment, as you can see in the low picture, which is an example of 10 degrees rotation. Also, closed-loop haptics are a new addition to the toric EOL market. The loops have a second insertion on the EOL, and this anti-vaulting haptic technology is designed to reduce the effect of the capsular compression and gives EOL stability. We start to implant this lens last year, and we have so far very good results. For the large majority of cases, we have obtained the intended refraction within half a diopter, as you can see in the graph. The mean vector's components are also within less than half a diopter, and the mean rotation was less than 5 degrees. We also evaluated the post-op high-order aberrations. As you can see, the mean for all aberrations are inside the normal band for the general population, except, of course, the spherical aberration, since they are pseudophakic eyes. These results suggest a good optical quality vision after cataract surgery. Also, we wanted to evaluate the refractive stability for different pupil size. For that, we start to look to the predict for upper refraction, which is an estimate of the wavefront deviation. Wavefront measurements were performed in each eye by the same examiner using Xiwave software. The mean variation of the sphere and cylinder between 4 and 6 millimeters pupil diameter were evaluated. For the 10 cases observed, the sphere value variation was less than half a diopter, which is considered normal when compared to normal report population values. The myopic shift for the largest pupils seems, as expected, negatively correlated with the spherical aberration. The cylinder variation was only 0.19 diopters, which is less than the normal fluctuation of this value between exams. And these results indicated refraction stability for different pupil size. In conclusion, this EOL has provided efficacy, stability, and our first result seems to show pupil independence for spherical and cylinder power, which is really important to acquire excellent visual performance, especially for high cylinder corrections and large pupil cases, more usual in young and myopic patients. And that's it. Thank you for your attention.